that the name Indraloka is a Sanskrit word. It's the name of the heaven for the gods. And so I grew up, I was raised Hindu, and I grew up with this concept that all life is sacred and that we're all related. And I was fascinated, because my name is Indra, I was fascinated with the concept of Indraloka. So I just want to say that to explain, because a lot of people think the sanctuary is named after me, and it's not really. I'm more named after the concept of Indraloka. But the story I want to tell you, I'll be brief, is about a cow named Penny and a woman named Sue. Penny was one of my very best friends up until a couple of years ago when she crossed over. And Penny was a very wise cow. She had been used as a breeding cow on a beef farm, and the farmer did not think that transport was kind to do to the animals when transporting them to slaughter. So he decided that it would be better if he would go ahead and just kill the calves there at the farm, and that way they wouldn't have to go through the cruelty of transport. So Penny actually was forcibly impregnated year after year, and watched her babies killed year after year. So Penny came to the sanctuary, and immediately just, I would say she never forgot it, but she forgave us humans, you know, that were at the sanctuary. And she ended up becoming a mother to all of the animals, human and non-human, at the sanctuary. And one day, just a few months before she died, a woman named Sue visited. And I didn't hear this story until after Penny died, but Sue had found some quiet time alone with Penny and had purposefully wanted to come to the sanctuary and spend time alone with Penny, because Sue had lost her own child. She had lost a four-year-old child, and she was struggling. She was in deep despair and in deep grief. So she found Penny sitting on the hillside in a quiet moment alone, and went and sat with Penny, and they just communed together. And after a few minutes of that, tears started rolling down Penny's face. For those of you who don't know this, cows cry tears just as we do. So Penny started crying, and Sue started crying, and finally it was time for Sue to go home, and she got up and she gave Penny a big hug, and Penny just looked at her, and Sue said, you know, that look held so much of, you know, shared pain and grief, but also of the love and the hope that she had found in her new life in sanctuary. So after Penny died, Sue wrote me this letter, and she told me that that experience with Penny was the only thing that pushed her into moving forward towards her own health. And she, you know, of course she still grieves and she'll always grieve, but she found that there was hope again and that there was love again. And a nice thing is that Sue actually visited us again this past Sunday for our Thanks Living event, and she's doing great. She has new love in her life in many different forms, and is, you know, is truly living joyfully again. So I want to tell you that story because for me, that interaction between Penny and Sue embodies what Indraloka, and in fact, what all sanctuaries are about. We need these animals more than they need us. We need them. We have to save them because we as humans cannot survive without them. We do not understand who we are unless we understand it in connection to understanding who they are.
Thank you. I'm Renee King-Sonnen. I'm the founder of Rowdy Girl Sanctuary. And well, we are the very first that I know of beef cattle ranch in the country, quite possibly the world, that's actually converted and become a vegan farm sanctuary. I know there's one in Canada that's making some headway, but we, we're first, and it's been an interesting journey. I went vegan October 31st, 2014, and started the Vegan Journal of a Rancher's Life. December 24th, I talked to Howard Lyman. January the 8th, I started an Indiegogo campaign to buy my husband's cows. And February the 20th, 2015, we had our 501c3. I had bought my husband's cows, put them in the nonprofit. And our mission is to really reach across the divide and not preach to the choir, but to actually reach, which we have been, other ranchers, kids that are in FFA, 4-H, and we are developing programs right now to do that. We have 96 acres. Currently, we have 85 animals. And so I'm just really, really honored to be here, Eve. Thank you so much for putting this all together. You've been a joy to work with. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to be leading some questions, and I'm really looking forward to a discussion. And I'm not going to mention that this is going to be an election-free zone, don't worry. But I'm just going to mention, I'm the only one who gets to mention it, but I am going to say that there were two really interesting things, ballot measures, that one passed, one was defeated. In Massachusetts, 75% of the electorate voted to offer farm animals or require farm animals to have some small but important protections. And in Oklahoma, a ballot initiative was defeated that would have prevented the legislature from providing protection for farm animals. So I think we can see that this is an issue that is important to people. It's on both sides of the aisle. And farm sanctuaries have undoubtedly been a very growing part of this movement. However, what I would like to start off with talking about is that there are some people in the movement, and a very, very powerful part of the movement, the effective altruism, people who are into effective altruism, who are now channeling a large amount of the money that's coming into the movement, and a lot of money is coming into the movement, and they have very serious questions about farm sanctuaries, not whether it is worthwhile to save individual animals, but whether that is the most effective use of, when we're facing a situation of unimaginable, huge, uncountable numbers of animals living in absolute horror. We have to use every penny effectively, and our sanctuary is the most effective way. And I think this has really become a very important topic in the movement. So should people be giving money to sanctuaries, which a lot of people are, or should they be giving to advocacy organizations like Mercy for Animals and the Humane League and others? And you know, it brings up a lot of questions. How expensive is it to run a sanctuary? And are you reaching the people? You pointed out, Renee, so let's start with you. You pointed out that you don't want to preach to the choir. How do you manage? Because if only vegans come to visit the sanctuary, and obviously a lot of, I mean, if anybody's vegan here, they probably visited sanctuaries. That's what we like to do. How are the non-vegans there?
Well, I know that for us, the way that we're getting the non-vegans there is, you know, we're developing programs right now that are around, you know, like the former FFA, Future Farmers of America, 4-H. These kids, a lot of folks are reaching out to us because we are the first beef cattle ranch to do this. A lot of the kids that are in FFA and 4-H, they don't want to kill their animals. And so they're reaching out to us, and they're not vegan. Their families aren't vegan. But they reach out to us, they come to the sanctuary, they volunteer, they take care of their animals, and they become vegan. And so that's happening. Ranchers, families are reaching out to us, sisters, brothers. You know, when you're the first, when you do something like this, and the only way I know how to explain it is if you're an alcoholic, you're gonna wanna talk to another alcoholic. If you're a former rancher, you're going to want to talk to another rancher. I mean, I dare say that, you know, it would be kind of difficult for other ranchers to want to talk to a vegan from California or New York if they don't have that commonality. So that's how we're doing it. I mean, we're reaching across the aisle like that. And
that's smart.
Yeah, that's what we're doing.
Kathy, do you have something, are you being from New York, at least now? Mm-hmm. Do you have something to add to that about how to reach outside the choir?
Yes, but can I just first address what
you can
the original question? Okay, so there is, of late, particularly within the last couple years, a lot of talk about the ineffectiveness, the expense of the sanctuary model. But if you look at any social movement in history, there is no such thing as one size fits all. Social change doesn't happen through one approach. Any social change anywhere in the world has taken a multiplicity of approaches. And when you combine that truth with the fact with the fact that 85% of vegans don't stay vegan. Then you must give people the opportunity to sit in the grass and be licked to death by a cow.
Yeah.
You have to. Because if they are merely watching films or taking a vegan outreach brochure, it's not that all of these other efforts aren't important, because they are. But without the experience of having a turkey fall asleep in their laps, or a cow lick them over and over and over until they pull back because their cheek is burning, then it's just an abstract concept. It's something they feel like they should do. But once you know a cow as you know your dog, then it's altogether different. And so what we try to do, because it's sometimes, you know, it's like, I grew up in a very racist, no, let me not go down that path. It's too long a tangent. But once you see the truth and you understand in your bones that we are the same in all the ways that matter, the differences between a chicken and a person are about as meaningful as the differences between black and white, man and woman, gay and straight, atheist and religious. They have nothing to do with what is in here. And people cannot know that if they do not know these animals. And so we try to do it, even though I want to go up to people.
I'm a little frightened.
Okay, so. You know, sometimes you want to go, all right, okay, you want to go up to people and say, why aren't you vegan? Like, you can't do that.
No.
Like, you can't do that. You have to, even if they say the most provocative thing designed to bait you, you have to have a heart that is wide open and accepts every single person where they are, and know that they've already done the thing. When they go to Indraloka or Rowdy Girl or CAS or Farm Sanctuary or what have you, they know they're not going to a petting zoo. They've already indicated through their behavior that on a certain level they're willing to change. So we have to lead and support with love.
So what you're saying is that the sanctuaries are there as much to reinforce people's veganism as to cause it?
To cause it, to reinforce it, to support it, to encourage the next step. If you went to McDonald's last week when you came, then this, you know, go to Burger King and get the veggie burger this time. To, you know, they're, yeah.
Indra, did you have anything to add?
Yeah. First of all, wow. There's a lot of wisdom sitting next to me, and this is a pretty cool place to be. I just wanted to add to that another approach that we've taken that has been very successful is with kids. And in particular with education opportunities for kids that may not necessarily be about compassion or veganism or farm animals. For example, we do a lot with environmental education. We've done things even further afield. We've had teachers come to us before. I had a teacher come once and say, you know, I've got a couple kids in my class that just cannot figure out algebra. And I think it's because it's too abstract for them. And so we were chatting about this, and we came up with this idea, and we tried it out, and it worked. Where we brought the kids to the sanctuary, and we told them the truth, which was we have to know how much our pigs weigh in order to take good care of them, in order to know how much food that they need. And so we showed them what the formula is to find out what a pig's weight is. You can't put a pig on a scale. So you have to measure them around the girth, you have to measure their length, and you have to figure it out, you know, using a formula. So we had the kids doing that, and then we took that and we said, okay, here's another formula then for their weight, for how much they should be eating. And so we did another formula for that, and then we did it with a goat, and we did, you know. And next thing you knew, these kids were doing algebra, and they were loving it because they were giving pigs belly rubs, and they were having a goat follow them around everywhere they went, and it was fun. And so guess what? They ended up learning compassion. We had another program with an architecture professor who brought her kids to the sanctuary for a class she called Farmatecture, where they had to design and build eco-friendly housing for the animals. So that meant they had to be at the sanctuary a lot over the course of the semester. And guess what? You know, every time they sat down at the picnic table for lunch, a cow would walk up and ask them for some salad. And, then, and every time, you know, yes. So everything they were doing, yes. Depending on the cow. But so, in other words, they made friends with the animals. It wasn't the intention of the course, but it's what ended up happening. And a lot of those kids ended up asking us for recipes and asking for information and taking our little veg starter kits that happened to be around various places. And, you know, so a lot of change happens with, especially with young people, when they're simply relaxed enough to learn something, because, you know, the animals, they're their own best, what's the word, they're their own best ambassador. You know, you can't help but fall in love with them when they're free and they're able to act as who they really are. They're fun.
You know, I just want to interrupt a little, and I don't want to be a naysayer, and I love sanctuaries, and I've been to your sanctuary, I haven't been to yours. And as I said, Farm Sanctuary was a very important part of my process. But I'm not really one of those people who gets around, who lies down with the pigs and cuddles, you know, and I think it's nice that those chickens are there, but that's not what it was for me, and I'm sure that's not what it is for everybody. It was a matter of social justice, and I'm just not that touchy-feely person. So I guess one of the questions, yeah, especially with humans.
So watch it.
I'm going to go sit over here. So when we're talking about sanctuaries, we're not talking about reaching everybody. And I guess what I want to talk about is a little bit about money. Because that is one of the questions that's been raised. It's not, I mean, I don't think anybody in the effective altruism movement thinks, oh, sanctuaries are just terrible. Like, we shouldn't, you know, like, obviously we're caring for these animals and that's a good thing. But is it the best use of money? So how expensive is it to run a sanctuary? And how do we avoid having sanctuaries, and it certainly has happened, run into substandard care? Should we be giving them the same kind of care that we give our companion animals? Is that the standard? And how do we avoid having sanctuaries that aren't doing that?
I'm going to go first. We should take turns.
I don't mind. Yeah. So, you know, we're new. Last year, we spent $96,000. I mean, that's how much we brought in. We spent just about every bit of that.
I'm sure.
This year, we brought in more than that so far. That's pretty cool to be in our second year. And how much does it cost? Well, you know, we recently went through a flood, the Brazos River flood, and we had to evacuate 80 animals. And I can tell you that from that flood cost us $30,000 from June until just, you know, the end of September. That's what it's cost. It's just to repair the food we lost, just everything we lost. But how much does it cost generally? Golly, you know, we're probably about, for us right now, about $6,000 a month for everything we're doing. But, you know, we own the land. Our sanctuary does not pay rent except for $1 a year that I convinced my husband to lease it to us for in the very beginning. You know, when he told me he'd let me buy the cows, I said, and you're gonna let me lease it for $1 a year, right? Well, yeah, so you know.
Would that be one of the ways that one could ascertain whether a sanctuary is going to be able to care for these animals properly, whether they own the land they're on, or whether?
I think it's very important, and that's one of the things that, I mean, thank God we own the land. You know, thank God my husband was a former rancher and had the equipment, the tractors. You know, the trailers, the hay balers. Thank God my husband knew how to do these things as a former rancher, because I couldn't imagine otherwise, you know, how having to learn all that from the ground up. you know, my husband wasn't at all thrilled about doing this in the very beginning, but now he's on board. And so now Rowdy Girl is looking at growing up. You know, we've got to buy our own tractors. We got to buy our own trailers. We're looking right now at, you know, the possibility of buying the land we sit on. But we may buy another parcel of land. You know, all these things are stuff we're still talking about. So, you know, we just got through getting out of that flood. You know, recently we did really, you know, it's kind of like a silver lining. It brought a lot of people together for us. And so only being in our second year, we're still looking at what things cost, you know, because we've gone from 29 farmed animals. We had 6 chickens and 4 horses when I first started to, you know, a little over 85 animals now. And I can tell you this, I'm constantly fundraising and I'm constantly, you know, building structures, constantly trying to figure out how much food we need, constantly, constantly, constantly. And we just keep measuring, we just keep coming up to the bar. We do whatever we have to.
Yeah, anytime I've noticed, I have been in a sanctuary or known anything about how it's run, I know it's a constant struggle, and because these animals need a lot of care. Kathy, you nodded vigorously when I said, should these animals get the same care that we provide for our companion animals? What do we do about sanctuaries that aren't providing that kind of care?
We as a culture, it is too easy to start a farm sanctuary. It is too easy to start an animal sanctuary. Way too easy. You fill out some forms, right? It's difficult. It's difficult from the amount of work involved, but from a legal point of view, it is far too easy for people to form sanctuaries. And I now have a checklist that I have someone help me with, that when somebody emails to say they want to come chat about starting a farm sanctuary, my helper first has a conversation with them to see if they have the remotest chance of succeeding at starting a sanctuary, because you can't simply have a big heart and think that, you know, if you build it, they will come, and so many think that. So there needs to be a process through which sanctuaries perhaps have to clarify their mission, develop some sort of business plan, show some ability to fundraise, or there needs to be a support network out there of, for example, more experienced sanctuaries, which is something we're working on right now, to help the newbies. In the first couple of years, holy mother of God, it was hard. Oh my God. And it, not that it's easy now, like I'm still working 80 hours a week, but it's different. So a support network, perhaps a little more rigor in determining who the process for coming to the sanctuary.
I mean, there are accrediting agencies, aren't there?
Yeah, and actually, yes. One of the things that we're working on, I'm sure Kathy and Renee, you've probably been involved as well, is helping. So the Global Federation of Animal Sanctuaries has an accreditation process. Up until recently, they didn't have a lot of experience with sanctuaries for farmed animals.
Right.
They started originally doing wildlife sanctuaries and then horse sanctuaries. So now a number of sanctuaries are working with them to help them to understand what it takes to have a sustainable sanctuary for farmed animals. What are the standards of care, but also what are the standards of governance, the standards of finance, the standards of all the other things that go into it, in addition to the care of each individual species, and creating a stronger, better system so that we have that information out there, and then also creating steps to accreditation. Right now, accreditation is a big mound of paperwork, and not every sanctuary has the time and the ability to do it. However, we can break it up into pieces and say, okay, let's work on this piece first. Let's work on your care standards for chickens. Let's work on your employee handbook. Let's work on so take it in pieces and help step by step get to that point. Mm-hmm. Ideally, before starting the sanctuary, or at least very early on. I think that can really help. I wish that I had had that when I started. I often tell people I've made every mistake that there is to make. It's a miracle that the sanctuary, you know, survived until as I was learning, and I'm continuing to learn every day. I mean, this is not work where you finish learning. I want to go back to the part of your question that was about then the money and how effective is it to, you know, to have a sanctuary when it's so much money in terms of advocacy work.
Right.
And I think what's important, and I think we need to do a lot more studies on this, and we're at NYU now, maybe there's some students here who want to work on this. I think what's important is that we need to have a better understanding of the efficacy of advocacy work through sanctuaries. It is my firm belief that the connections that are developed create much longer term sustained change when you have a relationship with actual farmed animals. Mm-hmm. I haven't done any kind of studies on that. It's just my perception and what I've spoken to my colleagues about. But
it has certainly been my feeling, I mean, I'm not an expert in the effective altruism movement, and it's really just starting in its process to be applied to animals and the issues. And the research is at a very nascent stage. I think it's enormously important for us to spend our money well, because let's face it, the changes that we're trying to create are staggering. But a lot of research remains to be made, and I'd love to see that research being done with sanctuaries.
Can I just feed off this a little bit? I completely agree. We do need to be measuring everything that we do, but I also don't want us to make the mistake of labeling sanctuaries as only sanctuaries, because many, our educational component is ultimately far more important than those, as much as we love every chicken, every cow, every pig, every sheep. The educational component
of
sanctuaries, of many sanctuaries, is quite strong.
That would have to be the focus. Because, I mean, saving the animals is a wonderful thing to do, but it's not advocacy, it's not changing the world. I mean, to save a life is wonderful, but...
But there are billions left that need to be saved.
So,
and there's never going to be enough sanctuaries to save them all.
We'd be talking, no, that would be hard. even if we could get them to, if everybody went vegan tomorrow, it would be confusing to know how to deal with that. So, other situations, the ethical issues that come up with sanctuaries is, how do you say no, and how do you let them go? How do you euthanize?
Do you want me to start on that one?
And when I say how do you say no, I mean you have too many animals.
So how do you say no to intakes, to new rescues? How do you say no to
Say no to an animal who needs to be rescued and maybe is dropped on your doorstep and you really just can't afford to bring it? Yeah. I'm sorry, you're right, Kathy. I should point out. I'm going to Indra to start with this.
Okay, so there's two parts to that question. How do you say no, and how do you handle euthanasia?
Yeah, it's definitely a double question.
That's a double question. So this is, unfortunately, a reality of all of our work. If we don't say no, we will be comp reporters. We get calls and emails every single day, all of us do, every sanctuary that I know does, with far more animals needing rescue than we can take them. So my philosophy has been that my first obligation is to the animals that are already in our care, and making sure that we have the space, the resources, and the help that we need to care for them. When we have enough space, resources, and help to take someone else, that's when they take them, and not before that. What we try to do in every single case is we try to reach out to our colleagues in other sanctuaries and see if we can't find a place for them. Or we try to educate the people who are trying to to save the animal about how they might, if they're a smaller animal, maybe they might be able to keep them. So we try to do as many things as we can, but at the end of the day, I know there have been animals who have died because Indraloka Animal Sanctuary didn't have the space or the resources or the help to take care of them. And that's hard, but that's a reality, and there's always going to be more. So that's kind of part one to that question. Part two is, how do we approach euthanasia? And I think that's an important question, too. So we get to know the animals really well because we live with them day in, day out, 24 hours a day, we're with them. And they're our friends and they're our family. And we get to know our vets really well too. and we pretty much work with them day in, day out as well. So what we do is if we feel in our hearts that this particular animal is having more pain than joy, and we are convinced that our vets are correct, and sometimes we'll go to several to make sure that there is no way to give them more joy than pain, then that's when we make that decision. And I go back to just looking into their eyes and looking into my heart.
Yeah, I mean, obviously that's the situation that any of us who have had a companion animal has generally needed to face. Though it's, you know, some of us have gone broke making that decision. Mm-hmm. Because you can make a lot of heroic decisions, and I would assume that sanctuary, people who run sanctuaries, there has to be a point where it does, how do you feel about this, where it does deviate from what at least some people would do for their companion animals, because you could spend your whole budget if it's the wrong disease and the wrong animal. At some point you have to pull the plug.
We could have kept going with this little calf named Little Guy, a little Hereford calf who was born very crippled. I don't know if anybody saw any of the videos of Little Guy. Oh, like we could have sent him for surgeries and all kinds of things, but far before another dog in your life would have. Some beings want their very last breath, and some don't have that same determination or life force. And so, Little Guy, it was perhaps the most painful death I've ever experienced, or one of them. But when he stopped trying to get up, we stopped. That was clear as day that he was done. I don't think we would have a situation where, you know, if you are at the point where you're spending, if it's a dog or a cat or a cow or a goat, $5,000 and $10,000 and $15,000 to keep an animal alive, then are you doing it for the animal or are you doing it for yourself? And that is the other thing you have to, not for a moment, can you keep an animal alive because you are not ready to say goodbye. And so I don't really think there's a situation, we've never encountered one where we've spent thousands and thousands and thousands. I know sanctuaries that do, but in my view, they're doing it for themselves, not for the.
Well, I think it's. I mean, it is certainly a struggle that one faces with one's companion animals as well. So it's a familiar struggle. Am I doing this for myself, or because I can't let him go, or am I doing it because he still wants to keep going?
I just want to quickly address
please.
That point. And I want to hear what Renee has to say too, but the difference between a struggle with companion animals is that you may have, you know, one or two or several over your life. In a sanctuary, you have hundreds of them. So we deal with death all the time, and
That's
we deal with illness
point.
All
That's
the time. And we know when there's hope and when there's no hope.
Yeah.
In the beginning, when I had dogs and cats, as I was younger, before I had the sanctuary, I went through that. I went through that heroic measures and trying to save someone and, you know, you gain experience and you know when there's a chance and when there's not. You have the instinct and you know it. And because we deal with death so much as we love them, we understand that life is going to
could. You know, there's paperwork that has to be filled out. There's a procedure. And, you know, if people don't want to go through a procedure, you know, for us anyway, we just can't, like, take an animal, you know, without going through some sort of a procedure, especially when I'm in New York and I don't know where they were, I think they were in California actually, and wanted to transport a baby calf from California to Texas. And I'm like, wow, really? You know, just it's that sort of thing. Sometimes it's difficult.
No doubt that you have to be a tough cookie to run a sanctuary. I know there's a lot of difficult decisions that have to be made. Now, this question is it's a fascinating quote, and I give credit to Eve for finding it, from Sue Donaldson and Will Pimlica's article on sanctuaries. Farm animal sanctuaries enable forms of animal viewing that may reinforce implicit assumptions about a human entitlement to confine and display animals. The quote goes on, but I'll leave it at that, because I just think it's a fascinating point. And I think it must be something that you all struggle with to avoid, and yet it's difficult, because a farm animal sanctuary ends up looking, well, not like a farm, but it ends up looking like the farm that we were told was a farm when we were kids. And so even that farm is not the image that we wanted to display to people. We don't want, I mean, we want people to see that these animals live here, and they're happy here, and this is their home, not their farm. But how do you go about avoiding that and sort of reinforcing the wrong image of who these animals are? You talked about education programs. Is that one of the ways that you deal with this, Kathy?
If you have enough acreage, you can decide who lives where. Any sanctuary is constantly moving animals around based on friendship groups, newcomers, but also, I would think, what animals crave interaction and what animals really don't want, would really be happier if we really didn't ever have visitors. So our outgoing in your face, like come love me, I wish we were open for visitors every day. Like those animals live at the front of the farm.
Yeah.
And the more aloof ones live at the back. And we don't, one of our best tour guides is here right now.
Rocky!
And we don't, you know, the tours don't go to those animals. And so I don't think I really understand your question. I don't know if I'm answering it.
Maybe I didn't explain it well. If it looks like a farm, and these are people who, you know, they're not vegan animal rights activists, it looks like a farm. It looks like a place where animals are commodified. How do you avoid that? How do you avoid having this as a farm, the animals are cute.
Here's how you do it. You do it, would you like to answer that question? Like you do it through your educational program. So next to the pig pastures, we have three gestation crates.
Yes.
And when we do the tours, we climb into the gestation crates and we talk about the intelligence and the emotional, like pigs are every bit, and so obviously every bit as emotional as humans. They laugh. They have temper tantrums, you know. And so to show them there, but to say this is not how they live. They live like this. They live in these. And we have battery cages, and we have, you know, so that's partly how we do.
Renee, I would think this would be an interesting challenge for you, because it was a ranch, and now it's a ranch.
And she's in,
but it's a very different ranch.
In,
how do you disrupt that mentality that people come in with, that this is a ranch, might be a nice one, but they're just farm animals?
Yeah, well, you know, it's a great question, because before we became a sanctuary, you know, the mentality of the cows had the mentality of livestock, of cattle. That was their mentality, because we treated them that way. Once we started converting and becoming a sanctuary, the entire attitude shifted. I started hanging out with them more. I was naming them. I was looking for the mannerisms, the nuances, even the ones that were, you know, 20 of them or so. I think there was like 20 of them, like they were solid black, almost 20. You know, it's hard to tell who's who, but you get to where you can look at their brow, you can look at their little notch on their head, you can look at the way they grin, the way their tail shaped. And you start to notice who they hang out with. You know, and it's true. You notice who they hang out with. You notice who the babysitters are. I mean, they've got babysitters, these cows. And, you know, and so when guests come, we take folks out on a hayride, you know, when we can. We load up hay bales and put them on a trailer, and we go off. And like Kathy said, you know, we have our socializing cows, like, that are at the front. And there are some, like Houdini, you know, Little Surprise. You know, there's some of these that are so, they love hugs. Fireball, he's our ladies' man. All the girls want that tongue across their face. You know, and so these animals are very, very sociable. I mean, I can literally lay in the field with Houdini, Surprise. I can lay there with them and put my head on their shoulder. Surprise will come up and put his head on me, you know, just one attention. Now there's some, Agape, she will dance with you. When I say dance, that ain't like, you know, that's a Texas whip. Yeah, she will, you know, chase you around. And she's about 10.
Really?
Yeah, she's about 10 years old, and she's, but you know, with some of them, the ones that have the herd mentality, the ones that were there before we became a sanctuary, they're starting to relax. The red trailer doesn't go off and take the babies to the cell barn anymore. You know, it's been a couple of years, so you can feel that they've relaxed. And when we take folks out on the tour, we don't just let them all get out with those cows. We don't let that happen because they could get hurt. We let them appreciate them from afar. You know, I may get out with them and show them the difference and the nuances, but, you know, that's how we do it with the cows.
The cows really do it themselves.
Yeah, they do. They do. They show us exactly what they want us to see.
And do you think that's conveyed to the people who are visiting?
Absolutely.
That this isn't just a nice ranch where happy cows are turned into happy steak?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. They can tell. They can tell. Well, they're all named. Every one of our cows have a name. I mean, everyone.
Well, and I have to say, I don't know of a single sanctuary, though there are some who aren't as forward with their educational piece as others. I don't know of a single sanctuary who just says, here, come hang out with our cows and chickens.
No, of course not.
I think we all, to varying degrees, have a vegan message.
Right.
Yeah. I want to just say one thing, which is that you can see it in their eyes. And we point this out to guests all the time. You can see it in their eyes. If you go to a farm or you have a newly rescued animal from a farm, their eyes are dull. They have so that nobody misses it. An important distinction.
And speaking of education and perhaps broadening your message, what kinds of ways can the sanctuary go beyond the sanctuary? And you know, I'm thinking of a couple of examples, and one is Esther. Esther the Wonder Pig, you're probably familiar with her. She ended up in the household of these two lovely young men, and they were completely confused as to how they ended up with this enormous, she turned out to be a food pig. And became very, very large. And they turned her into a social media sensation. These guys are the best social media experts on the face of the planet. Esther just became a star. I mean, everything that she said was hilariously funny. And now they built a sanctuary around her. And I'm kind of curious, like, is it worth, you know, why wasn't Esther just, she was changing the world on her own. Why did she need a sanctuary? But also, once you have the sanctuary, how do you, you know, you have animals who are as charming as Esther. How do you get outside the sanctuary with your animals and reach people who can't come visit? And the other, I know I'm giving a 12-part question. What the hell? The other thing is, how do you get press? And that's something I want you to talk about, Renee, because you have gotten some really amazing press. So let's start with that, and then we'll talk about the question of going beyond press to social media and other strategies.
Thank you. Yeah, we, you know, I'll be 59 years old. And in my other life before sanctuaries, you know, I was a producer. And I had a country and western rock and roll band.
She's very, very good. We should have her sing before we
leave. I love that idea.
And, you know, and I've also produced, you know, I had a Texas Women in Country Music platform I produced. And you know, I was a realtor. I've always been an entrepreneur. You know, I had a medical spa, I was partnered with doctors. So this is my background. You know, my background is in figuring out how to do it. You know, I figure out how to do things. And so when this happened, you know, business plan, are you kidding? I always had a business plan before, a marketing plan for everything I did. But what happened to me this time was a matter of the heart. When my heart shifted and I became vegan and I knew I could no longer do what we were doing at the ranch, you know, it was where the rubber met the road. And so when we became a sanctuary, I just kicked in to everything I knew. Every attribute the good God has given me, I put to use. I now know why I have been given the skills I've been given. And so how do I do it? I have, the best way I can describe it is I have my fingers on the pulse of everything we do. And I never think that I can't do something. I always know that there's something higher and bigger at work, working through me. And I just keep reaching, you know? There was the Texas Country Reporter was at our house, our sanctuary, 2 days ago. I didn't know it was gonna be on national TV. We're gonna have a national, our sanctuary is gonna be on national TV first quarter. I always like to say, you know, the country knew about our sanctuary before our next door neighbor. And it was true, because I reached out through social media, not having any idea how to do what I was doing, except I just kept feeling it. I kept feeling it. I didn't operate through fear. I kept feeling it and kept doing the next right thing, and I always went to the top. Figured out who I needed to talk to, Howard Lyman, Gene Bauer, Susie Costin. I went to these folks. I didn't know who they were. I had never heard of them at all. But this is what I think a lot of people fall short, is they're afraid to make steps. They're afraid to make strides. There can be no fear. We have to know that there's something at work. And, you know, I was telling somebody, you know, somebody approached me about a feature film. I'm like, what? Okay, at first I'm like scared, right? But there's a part of me that goes, okay, well, I'm putting this over here. We'll talk to the board. You know, I don't know what's in store. I just know there's something bigger at work than what I am. And I just show up and I let whatever is supposed to be happening happen through me. And I really do believe that that we have to start having bigger platforms on TV, on radio, in film. Our movement needs this. Our sanctuary movement, I was talking to Eve about this earlier. You know, we need our own conferences. I mean, it's great to have an animal rights conferences, but I think sanctuaries need conferences, because we need to come together as sanctuary leaders and discuss these things. I know I need help. You know, I need a lot of help. You know, I mean, I'm just doing this by the seat of my pants.
We're all making it up as we go.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, that's what we do. I mean, newspaper, radio, TV, whatever we need to do, I think we have to do these things.
I agree, in theory. However, when you do that, you know, we had a little 1 pound, we had a premature little triplet, Violet. She was born at 1 pound. She was this big. Everybody thought she wasn't gonna make it. She did. We made a little video. It went viral. And for a few weeks, we had too many visitors. There is a consequence to sanctuaries. Publicity brings visitors, and visitors are complicated. You want them, but you don't want 1,000 a day.
No.
You don't. You don't have the parking, you don't have, you know, and suddenly you do become a zoo. And so, we can't do these things. We've turned down TV opportunities for that very reason. This stuff is very complicated.
So do you think it's more important to have visitors, which is obviously going to reach far fewer people, than to pursue the TV opportunity? Or let's look at the Esther situation, which is more valuable, their social media explosion.
How do you measure?
Or their sanctuary.
How do you measure value? To me, I want to know, when I get to my dying day, I want to know that I did everything that I could to help the least among us. And that's why we are really going to start measuring the impact of everything we do. We measure the impact of tours. The sweet woman is a, you guys should know about this woman, Janae Claiborne. She's a vegan chef and she's very good, so you should talk to her if you don't know her. But we measure the impact, you know, we do surveys and things, but what is success? Is it to create vegans? You know, we can all feel good when people have these teary or these transformative moments, but if 6 months down the road, mm-hmm. culture and family and habit have kicked in and trumped this good experience.
You're not allowed to use that word.
I thought. Then what is that? What is the next thing that we do? So I think it's about how you define success. And looking really wisely at all your choices and measuring so that you know you are doing good rather than just crossing your fingers and hoping you're creating and sustaining vegans.
Well, I mean, you mentioned before that you think an important role of the sanctuary is sustaining vegans, not just creating them. And that short-term changes can be made perhaps through social media, but you feel the actual connection is more important in
not more
sustaining.
Important. I think I know from 16 years of doing this. This guy, you know, not that long ago, this big burly. Oh, I have two stories, both about big burly men.
I only have one time for one, so combine them.
Okay, two big. I'll get to the bullet points. Big burly man went on a tour, stood in the parking lot with holding my hand, like big burly cowboy guy. Holding my hands, sobbing, like, and then all he said was, I get it, tell me what to do. So that is what sanctuaries do. And then last weekend we had a call for pumpkins for the pigs, and another big burly guy in a flannel shirt said that he had come on a tour the previous weekend, and he said, I'm vegan, so, creating versus sustaining. Well, we got to do both because you've got that 85% that don't stay. So we've got to be a part of doing both, but we cannot have the arrogance. We in this movement cannot have the arrogance or the narrow-mindedness or the naivete to think that sanctuaries are going to create that one part is all that we need. As I said in the beginning, every social movement happens when a multiplicity of approaches are coalesce and
I want to ask a question because I need to know. You turned down the TV because of what again?
Because we've actually turned down TV a couple times because we are not prepared for what the attention would bring. I think it would. We already, as Rocky knows, we struggle sometimes on weekends with sometimes having almost too many people, and the tours get unmanageable. Then you have the little kid chasing the chicken. We have a lot of free-range animals.
So, we don't have tours every weekend, and I don't want tours every weekend. I have a tour every quarter, and I don't have tours. Hardly ever. Yeah.
So who comes on the hayrides?
Well, we have scheduled tours. Like
ours are scheduled.
Every quarter, maybe. And then we have a private, we had a little hayride for Halloween. But it wasn't like every weekend. Like we do just, there's no way I can have visitors every weekend. We work around there. And so my reason for wanting to do this is not for fame. It's to get the attention that these animals need. I mean, I'll be 59 years old. I think we're running out of time. I really do believe that we are running, we're in a position to where if we don't start doing something, like now that we are a sanctuary, we do have a business model. And it is to create more sanctuaries, more, get more land, more room so we can rescue more animals and make more of an impact, you know?
I think the model needs to be? You know how there in virtually every county in the United States there is an SPCA? there needs to be a sanctuary in every county in the SPC, in the country, so that every human, every American can go and have that experience with that cow or that pig or that sheep.
But let me ask you, Renee, just to be, I seem to be assigned to be the devil's advocate. I mean, you were saying that most of what you do isn't based in tours. It's based on the, you've been able to get great press, you might have a movie deal, like all of these wonderful ways, sort of on the Esther model, like reaching out beyond the sanctuary. So why would you not want to grow that piece rather than grow the amount of land you have and the number of animals you have?
If why you would we want to do what?
Grow that piece, your ability to reach people through
media.
The press, through media, through a movie. Why isn't that your focus rather than more land, more animals?
Well, I think it's a combination of those things. I mean, we're only 2 years old. I mean, I keep my fingers on the pulse. I pay attention to the rhythm, to the ebb and the flow. And that's the way I make my moves. And I, you know, and talk to our board. You know, that's the only way I know to do it. I mean, I'm not trying to make one or the other my focus. I'm thinking that, you know, in our, we're creating a rancher advocacy program, and we're creating a program called Families Choosing Compassion. And I really do want to, like, I've had folks call me wanting to know how to do this, right? I'm sure all of you do. How do you do this? How do you do this? Well, we're only 2 years old, you know, barely. And the only thing I know is that I'd like to be able to help people plug in, have a model that's got a publicity engine, that's got a fundraising engine, that's got a networking arm. We got a website working. Why not help people do this that has a model already in existence? That's the kind of the things we're thinking.
Indra, do you want to add anything? I think after we've...
The original question was about how we reach people who are not necessarily coming to visit sanctuaries. And my answer would be that we each do it in the way that we have talents. So Kathy and I both write. You know, we tell the animal stories. Renee is great with publicity and the cameras and singing and the things that she does, the performance. There's other sanctuaries who have, you know, everybody has their own unique skill set, artists, painters. Derek and Steve from Esther have their wonderful sense of humor. You know, so everybody uses their skills and gets out there with those to tell the animal stories.